counterterrorism efforts. His other recent book, as I had already mentioned, co-authored with John Collin, examines the rise of cyber threats across America. Today, he serves as the director of the Aspen Institute's Cybersecurity and Technology Program, and has contributed to Wired, Long Reads, and CNN. He's written for publications from Esquire to the New York Times, and has served as the editor of two of Washington's most prestigious magazines, The Washingtonian and Political Magazine, which he helped lead to its first national magazine award, the industry's highest honor. On this book, author and historian Michael Beschloss has said, Garrett Graff has deftly used oral history to take us into one of the most horrific and consequential moments in American history, in a book that will be particularly important for those readers too young to remember 9/11. It is the true challenge of historians to record history so that the next generation can understand these momentous events. I will also add that the only plane in the sky is currently sitting on the number four on the New York Times for combined print and ebook, and the number five on the hardcover fiction lists. And it is an absolute great pleasure to once again welcome Mr. Garrett Graff back to the Ford Museum.
Good evening, everyone. Thanks for coming out, and it's a pleasure to be back here in Grand Rapids. For those of you who came to my talk last year on nuclear war, thanks for coming out for another uplifting night of discussion of American history. So this book, as Joel laid out, is an oral history of 9/11. It is 9/11 told through the voices of those who lived it, 480 Americans morning to night, coast to coast. And to give a little bit of grounding in the work before I start talking about it, I wanted to start by reading one of the short chapters. The book is 64 sort of finely sliced chapters in chronological order across the country. And this is a chapter that takes place inside air traffic control and the US military from about 8:25 Tuesday morning, September the 11th, until about 8:50 that morning. Peter Zaleski, air traffic controller, Boston Center, Nashua, New Hampshire. When American Airlines Flight 11 came to me, the pilot said, Boston Center, this is American 11, climbing to flight level 230. I called him many, many times, American 11, how do you hear? American 11, this is Boston Center, do you hear me? I'm calling and calling, and I'm like, my God, they must be up there drinking Dunkin' Donuts coffee. Honestly, that's what I was thinking. Then there's these transmissions. The first transmission from the aircraft, it's garbled. I don't understand it. Then there was a second one, a voice. I remember him saying, nobody move, please. We're going back to the airport. I will never forget that feeling up the back of my neck. It was like this adrenaline or something. I felt fear. I'm like, oh my God, the plane's been hijacked. Colin Scoggins, airspace specialist and military specialist, FAA, Boston Center. I came in about 8:25 in the morning, and as soon as I walked in the front door, someone came to me and said that there was a hijack going on. We'd worked hijacks in the past, and they were usually uneventful. Peter Zaleski. I yelled at the supervisor, John, get over here. The plane's been hijacked. Absolutely. I go, it's Middle Eastern voices, positive. I could tell that second time. I was used to working Egypt Air, Saudi, Turkish, all of them. It's definitely Middle Eastern voices. Colin Scoggins. The pilot on American 11, Mohammed Atta, the lead terrorist, stated something about more planes, that they had more planes. It was definitely plural. That's when things really started to ramp up. Ben Sliney, FAA Command Center, Herndon, Virginia. I was the National Operations Manager on 9/11. That is a position located in the Washington area that has overarching authority over the nation's airspace. That was my charge, the safe and efficient operation of the nation's airspace. Colonel Bob Marr, Commander, Northeast Air Defense, Rome, New York. There was a huddle of people around one of the radar scopes. I saw that huddle and thought, there's got to be something wrong. Major General Larry Arnold, 1st Air Force, Tyndall Air Force Base, Georgia. We had a major North American air defense exercise that morning, a command post exercise. There was a team of people who introduced scenarios you had to react to and respond to. As we were winding up the exercise, my executive officer handed me a slip of paper. He had said, Bob Marr called, and there was a hijacking in the Boston Center. Ben Sliney, my experience with hijackings and our protocol was that we cooperate. Lieutenant Don Deskins, Mission Commander, Northeast Air Defense. At this point, our mindset was the 1970s vintage hijack. We didn't have a huge concern this aircraft was going to crash. Major General Larry Arnold. I said, Bob, go ahead and scramble the fighters. Major Joe McCready, F-15 pilot, Otis Air Force Base, Cape Cod, Massachusetts. A scramble order was issued. I ran to the jets. I started up. I realized we didn't have any weapons. They filled our jets with gas, and even though we were Winchester, that means we didn't have any weapons. We took off. Lieutenant Colonel Tim Duffy, F-15 pilot, Otis Air Force Base. When we took off, I left it in full afterburner the whole time. We were supersonic going down to Long Island, and my wingman, Nasty, that's Major Dan Nash, he called and said, hey, Duff, you're super. And I said, yeah, I know. Don't worry about it. I just wanted to get there. Colonel Bob Marr. At Mach 1, it would take them 16 minutes to get to New York. That's 10 miles a minute. Lieutenant Colonel Kevin Nisipany, Mission Commander, Northeast Air Defense. Almost simultaneously, we brought in more surveillance technicians to look at the scopes. Staff Sergeant Larry Thornton, Northeast Air Defense. The area was so congested, the hijacked flight was incredibly difficult to find. We were looking for little dash marks in a pile of clutter on a two-dimensional scope. Master Sergeant Joe McCain, Northeast Air Defense. We picked up a search track going down the Hudson Valley, straight in from the north towards New York. The plane was fast and headed in an unusual direction with no transponder. We watched that track until it faded over New York City. Lieutenant General Tom Keck, Commander, Barksdale Air Force Base, Shreveport, Louisiana. We were in the midst of this big annual exercise called Global Guardian. They loaded all the bombers, put the submarines out to sea, put the ICBMs at nearly 100%. It was routine. We did it every year. A captain came in and said, sir, we have an aircraft that hit the World Trade Center. I started to correct him, saying, when you have an exercise input, you have to start by saying, I have an exercise input. That way it doesn't get confused with the real world. Then he pointed me to the TV screens in the command center. You could see smoke pouring out of the building. Like everyone else in aviation that day, I said, how in a clear and a million day could a plane hit the World Trade Center? This book grew out of an article that I wrote for Politico magazine in 2016 for the 15th anniversary of 9/11. That was an oral history of being aboard Air Force One with President Bush. And I went out and I interviewed 28 of the people who were with the president that day, from the pilot of Air Force One to the fighter pilots who accompanied him, to White House Chief of Staff Andy Card, Karl Rove, Ari Fleischer, the other senior aides aboard the plane, the press, the security, the stenographer aboard the plane that day. Piece published, as I said, in 2016, and I was astounded by the reader feedback. I got, the day that it published, dozens, then ultimately scores, and finally hundreds of letters from readers of people sharing their own stories of 9/11 and their own reactions. And two of those reactions stood out to me, and two of them I just sort of couldn't get out of my mind. The first was from a mother, a veteran, who had two children, 7 and 9. And she said that she had printed out the article and set it aside so that one day when her children were old enough to read it, she could sit them down and explain to them why mommy had left them to go off to war. The second was another letter from another veteran, a younger guy, an Army veteran. He was in middle school on 9/11, and he'd done 3 tours, 2 in Afghanistan, 1 in Iraq. And he said that he had never really understood the nation's trauma on 9/11 until he had seen that article and seen the day through President Bush's eyes. And I just couldn't get past this idea that we were passing a world shaped by 9/11 on now to a generation who has no emotional connection or memory to it. And it's always hard to know when an apocal event shifts from memory to history, but I think you could make an argument that it's probably for 9/11 this year. This is the first year when you have college students arriving on campuses across the country born after 9/11. That this year, for the first time, we have American servicemen and women being deployed to fight in a war older than they are. And this year, in March, marked the beginning of the time when the first recruits to the New York City Fire Department, born after the attacks, could apply to join the fire service. And so my goal with turning that article into this book, which shares the same title, The Only Plane in the Sky, referring to the end of 9/11, when President Bush left off at Air Force Base outside Omaha, Nebraska, and flew back to Washington at about 4:15 that afternoon, after all of the commercial planes in the country had been grounded. And during that final leg of the flight, he was effectively the only plane left in the sky in North America. This book, the goal was not to capture the history of 9/11, but the goal was to capture what America experienced on 9/11. Because when you begin to go back to that day and you look at the memories that America has of that day, for those of us who are old enough to remember experiencing it, the story of 9/11 is actually pretty different than the story that we tell in our history books. That when you go back and we tell 9/11, we try to explain 9/11 to someone, we tell this very neat and clean history of that day. We say the attacks started at 8:46 with the crash of American 11 into the North Tower. And it ended at 10:29 with the collapse of the second tower 102 minutes later. But if you remember 9/11, that's not the day that you remember, and that's not the story that any of us lived that day. We didn't know when the attacks began. We didn't know when the attacks were over, and we didn't know what came next. And the fear and the trauma and the chaos and the confusion of that day is the true story of 9/11. Because when we try to hand this set of memories off to a new generation, to the quarter of the American population that no longer has any memory of 9/11, a quarter of the country now does not have a memory of 9/11. The facts of the day don't account for what the country did after 9/11. And that when you look at the world that we created, if you look at the way that 9/11 shaped our geopolitics internationally and our domestic politics here at home, you can't explain the world that we are handing off to a future generation simply by explaining the facts of 9/11. Because the decisions that our country made, the decisions that our leaders made, weren't driven by the history of 9/11. They were driven by the emotions of 9/11. They were driven by those, by that fear, by that trauma, by that chaos and that confusion. And so this book is an attempt to capture that sweep of the day, not as we understood 9/11 later, but as we understood 9/11 while it unfolded. And so to compile the book, it's a mix of original interviews that I did and then archived oral histories done by institutions like the 9/11 Museum in New York, the 9/11 Tribute Center, the Pentagon historian, the Capitol Hill historian, the Arlington County Public Library, the Flight 93 National Memorial that the Park Service compiled in Shanksville. And I found with a researcher who worked with me on this book, we found about 5,000 of those original oral histories archived around the country, and ultimately boiled it down to about 2,000 that I spent a year working with to end up telling the story that I tell in this book. And there's some themes and some big observations that sort of grow out of looking at 9/11 on a national level like that, that I want to spend some time talking about tonight. The first is just how different our country was on the morning of September 11th, that we sort of now say flippantly and in passing, 9/11 changed everything. But we forget just how much actually 9/11 changed. And to capture that, you actually have to look at what to me is the most fascinating moment of 9/11, which is the 17 minutes between the first crash and the second crash, 8:46 in the morning to 9:03. And what unfolds during those 17 minutes is that the country writ large, and New York specifically, watches that first crash and shrugs. And you probably, if you watched TV that morning, you probably remember going through this precise thought process. The TV was live at 8:49 that morning from the Twin Towers. It's 3 minutes after the first crash. And for 14 minutes, America watched that first crash. And I'll bet everyone in this room who watched said the same thing that I did, which is some combo of must be a small plane, must be a weird aviation accident, pilot had a heart attack, air traffic control is having a bad day, planes having some sort of mechanical problem. And that was the reaction to the from the whole country. One of the most breathtaking quotes in the book to me is from Peter Johansson, the captain of one of the New York commuter ferries, who talks about watching the first crash from New York Harbor as he's coming into the Wall Street Terminal in Lower Manhattan. Whole boat sees the crash. They continue on into Lower Manhattan. They dock, and every single commuter on the boat gets off and walks into work in Lower Manhattan. They walk off the boat through papers and envelopes fluttering down from the impact. There's not a single person on the ferry who says, you know what, this just kind of seems like it's gonna be a weird day, I'm gonna go work from home for the rest of the day. Brian Gunderson, the chief of staff to House Majority Leader Dick Armey that morning, you know, every congressional office has the TV in the reception as you walk into the office. He walks past it on the way into the morning staff meeting at 9. He looks at it and he says, I thought it was going to be like a bad school shooting, the type of thing that dominates national news but doesn't fundamentally affect anyone's day. President Bush and Condi Rice, the national security advisor that morning. Condi Rice calls the president. They talk about the crash. They talk about how strange the crash is. Condi Rice goes on into her 9 o'clock meeting, and President Bush walks into the classroom at Emma Booker Elementary School in Sarasota, Florida, to read to those school children. Robert Mueller, the FBI director, was in his second week on the job. He was, the way that the FBI was bringing him up to speed, he'd started Tuesday, September 4th, 2001. And every morning at 8 a.m., he was being briefed on the biggest cases that the FBI was working. At 8 a.m., Tuesday, September the 11th, he sits down for his first briefing on the investigation of Al-Qaeda and the bombing of the USS Cole. 49 minutes later, someone enters and tells him a plane has crashed into the World Trade Center. Bob Mueller, director of the FBI, sitting in a briefing on Al-Qaeda, has the same reaction as Lieutenant General Tom Keck, as I read you. He looks out the window of the director's conference room on the seventh floor of the Hoover Building at the blue sky that covered the East Coast that day and said, how on earth did a plane manage to hit the World Trade Center today? And then they go back to their meeting. Of course, at 9:03, we realize something very different is unfolding. We realize that we are under attack. And the day begins to unfold dramatically differently. And one of the things that sort of comes through from there is just how much the nation improvised its response to 9/11, just how much the country was unprepared for that day. And we saw sort of people at all levels make incredible decisions under incredibly different, difficult circumstances. And so I spent a lot of time in the book following some of the stories that you probably don't remember or may have never known in the first place from that day. Because one of the things that turns out that happened on 9/11 is that there were all of these things that, had they happened on any other day of the year, would have been among the most dramatic things individually that had ever happened in modern American history, but on 9/11 were not even among the 10 or 12 most interesting things that happened that day. And there are two of them that I spend a good chunk of time in the book talking about, the first being the maritime evacuation of Lower Manhattan, which was the, as it turns out, the largest maritime evacuation in world history, larger than the evacuation of the British from Dunkirk. And it was put together that morning by this incredible makeshift armada of pleasure yachts, some of them literally stolen from the marinas of Lower Manhattan, ferry boats, tugboats, fishing vessels, and all sorts of sort of civilian watercraft piloted by civilians pulling up and doing everything that they could to get people off of Lower Manhattan. 500,000 people evacuated from Lower Manhattan by boat that morning. Led by, organized by, a single young lieutenant in the US Coast Guard named Michael Day, who ends up with the pilots from the Sandy Hook Benevolent Pilots Association sort of coordinating this rescue effort on Lower Manhattan, and simply puts out a radio call saying, all available boats, anyone who can come, come to Lower Manhattan. And they fill that day and with just this incredible armada. And Lieutenant Day says in his oral history, I broke more laws that day than I have enforced in the totality of the rest of a 30-year Coast Guard career. The second sort of incredible Herculean effort that day was led by one of the men in the excerpt that I read to you, Ben Sliney. The effort by the FAA and air traffic control to put 4,500 planes on the ground that were in the air at 9:42 that morning after the crash at the Pentagon. Ben Sliney, the National Operations Manager for the FAA, was in his first day on the job as the National Operations Manager at the FAA. And in his first 90 minutes, gives two orders that no American has ever given before or since. Shortly after the second crash at 9:03, he institutes a nationwide ground stop. No plane that is not in the air will be allowed to take off across the country. And then at 9:42, the order to land all planes at the closest available airport, regardless of destination, and regardless of whether the airport is in any way prepared for all of the airplanes that are about to land at it. And it becomes this incredible story of an industry sort of behind the scenes operating without any protocols, without any procedures, that responds instantaneously to an unfolding national tragedy that unfolds, by the way, as they believe that there are still hijacked planes in the air. It's sort of one of the things that we forget when we talk about the sort of neat and clean version of the 9/11 history is how much confusion and how long the confusion rippled over the course of that morning. That as late as early afternoon, the US government believed that there might still be as many as a dozen further hijacked planes in the air. That as much as we now talk about these as the attacks on New York and the Pentagon and Shanksville, the fear that day was coast to coast. The Prudential Center in Boston was evacuated. The Sears Tower in Chicago was evacuated. The skyscrapers of Los Angeles were evacuated. In Florida, Disney closed. It's the first time and only time that Disney has ever closed because of a hostile act. And they evacuated the park, assuming that it was a target, assuming that all of these sky rises across the country were further targets. At the White House during that hour, they assume that there are more hijacked planes coming towards Washington. They know of at least one, United Airlines Flight 93. And you see the Secret Service agents shouting at the White House staff to evacuate, to take off your shoes and run. At the Capitol, similarly, they evacuate and tell people to run. And at the White House, they rush Vice President Cheney into the bunker under the North Lawn. And the Secret Service stand their posts, assuming that they are about to die as one of the inbound planes hits the White House. The supervisor in the Joint Operations Center at the White House stands up and shouts, "After impact, anyone who survives, go to the alternate command center and we'll pick up there." At air traffic control in Herndon, Virginia, during this time, Ben Sliney says, "Land every plane now." They put 750 planes on the ground in the first 10 minutes. This incredible nationwide effort. And we're sort of only familiar with like one really tiny bit of this story, which is the 38 planes that end up in Gander, Newfoundland. The transatlantic flights diverted to Canadian destinations, the 7,000 people dropped into Gander, into a town of 9,000 that are then housed there with 0 minutes notice for 4 days until the planes begin to return to the United States on Friday night and Saturday. And this is sort of the types of things, the stories that you find sort of buried amid the parts of 9/11 that we actually are quite familiar with, the Twin Towers, the Pentagon, and Shanksville. And the extent to which sort of America improvises a response with no plan and no procedures, and that sort of part of what makes that so interesting to me is that over the course of the day, when you look at 9/11 at the national level, the day that a school child had that day was just as confusing and confounding as the day that Ben Sliney had at the FAA, and just as confusing and confounding as President Bush had. And that it's sort of this, there was this national shared experience and emotion of that day that is really sort of fascinating to go back. And when you begin to look at it at the national level, you have a better understanding of why this day has such resonance with us as a country. Because we sort of all had the same day, whether we actually had anything to do with it or not. And that the sites of 9/11 are so indelibly printed in our minds, the blue sky, the planes, the crashes, the smoke. And that was the day that sort of all of America had. I open the book, actually, with the tale of Frank Culbertson, who on 9/11 was the one American off the planet Earth, the NASA astronaut aboard the International Space Station. And he talks about how, looking down from the International Space Station that day, he watched the day and the attacks unfold. That on the first pass, he actually watched the dust cloud of the second collapse over lower Manhattan. On the next pass, 90 minutes later, he could see the gash in the side of the Pentagon. And on the next path, he saw the empty skies, the contrails of the planes disappearing. And that two passes later, he remembers seeing the one contrail left over North America, the only plane in the sky, President Bush heading back to Washington from Offutt Air Force Base. And that as strong as the sights of 9/11 are, one of the things that I sort of spend a lot of time in the book talking about, because they were some of the memories that I found most fascinating as I was going through these oral histories, was that while most of us remember the sights, 9/11 for those who lived it was a full 360-degree sensory experience. And so it's the sounds of 9/11. It's what 9/11 tasted like, what 9/11 smelled like, what 9/11 felt like to the touch. When you go back and you look at the oral histories of the volunteer firefighters who go to Shanksville, every single one of them talks about the smell of the crash site, and how that is the memory that they will never forget. That when you talk to the first responders and the survivors of the collapse of the towers, they talk about the taste of the dust in their mouth. And it was like having a wool sock in your mouth, or like having a mouthful of Bisquick. And that when you talk to the people who arrived in Lower Manhattan over the course of the afternoon, the iron workers and the rescue workers who flooded in to try to find their colleagues, what they talk about is the dust and what it was like to walk through 6 inches of cottony, marshmallowy, fluffy, cottony, fresh fallen snow across Lower Manhattan. And then what everyone talks about coast to coast, and you probably, some of you in this room, many of you in this room probably remember this, is the profound silence of the afternoon of 9/11. That after the towers fell and schools let out and businesses let out across the country, the planes were grounded. Just how silent America was. And that was true for people in Lower Manhattan, and it was true, I quote, a person in Fargo, North Dakota, talking about how he remembers going out that afternoon and just how silent the skies were. And it was sort of this moment where the aviation noise of daily life we remember, or we don't realize how much we hear that until it's gone. The other thing that really comes through in looking at 9/11 at a national level is the incredibly huge role that random luck or fate played on that day. The way that incredibly minor life decisions, the types of decisions that we each make 1,000 times a day without ever imagining the alternate futures we could be unlocking, that day literally meant the difference between life and death. Michael LaMonaco, the chef at Windows on the World, the restaurant atop the North Tower, he would have normally been in his kitchen at 8:30 that morning. He was in his kitchen every day at 8:30. Except that that day he stopped in the basement of the World Trade Center in the shopping concourse to buy a new pair of glasses at LensCrafters and missed the last elevator to the top of the tower. 72 of his colleagues died, and he didn't. Joseph Lott was a computer salesman who was supposed to be at a conference at Windows on the World that morning. And he was having breakfast that morning in the Marriott Hotel, sort of sandwiched between the two Twin Towers. And at breakfast, one of his colleagues gifted him a new tie. She had been on vacation the week before, had seen a tie that she thought he would like, and bought it for him. He was so touched by the gesture that he said, "I'm going to go put this tie on. I'm going to go back to my room, change my shirt, and throw this tie on. You guys go on ahead to the conference." His colleagues died, and he didn't. Monica O'Leary on September 10th was the unluckiest person at Cantor Fitzgerald. She was laid off from Cantor Fitzgerald in the North Tower on the 108th floor on the afternoon of Tuesday, September 10th. She gathered up her belongings in a box and said goodbye to all of her colleagues and left. And she was home in time to watch General Hospital. The next day, all of her colleagues were killed. She started back at work at Cantor Fitzgerald the following week as the firm tried to rebuild and get back on its feet. And the thing was, since the entire HR department had been wiped out on Tuesday morning, no one had ever even taken her off payroll. That plays out over the course of the entire country over the course of that day. The number of people who switched their flights onto one of the hijacked planes or switched their flights off of the hijacked planes at the last minute. People stop for blueberry muffins and end up living that day because they decided that they were hungry on the way into work. The New York Giants game went late Monday night, September 10th. It was in Denver, and so it was played Mountain Time. And there are hundreds of people who lived on 9/11 because they just stayed up and watched the end of a football game and went into work at 9 instead of 8. And that you sort of see this play out in sort of ways big and small. Ben Sliney, his first day on the job at the FAA. And then in the Pentagon, we follow two women, Sheila and Louise, as they start their first day at the Pentagon on September 11th. And they are sitting in their office doing what you do in the first hour of your first day at work, filling out your personnel forms. And one of them collects the forms at about 9:30 and walks over to the fax machine. This was 2001, you actually had to fax something. And she walks up to the fax machine, loads the documents in, enters in the number, hits the start button, and the building explodes. And she's standing there, singed on fire, wondering what she did to the fax machine. And that she and her colleagues that day, many of her colleagues died. She and Sheila both end up surviving that day, getting out, in part because of the incredible efforts of some of her colleagues. And this is where, again, you sort of see these incredible stories of the human response to 9/11. And of course, we are familiar with the firefighters and the police officers and the EMTs and the paramedics who go into the towers and up the towers in New York. In the Pentagon, it's a story of military officers who run out of a burning building, realize their colleagues are still trapped inside, and turn around and run back in and end up saving every life that morning that gets saved. Every single person who survived the Pentagon was pulled from the Pentagon in the first 30 minutes. And so, but for sort of the work of the military officers sort of rushing right into that building, the death toll that day would have been much higher. And that this becomes sort of a story, again, that you see play out in lots of different ways. John Abruzzo, a quadriplegic working on the 64th floor of the North Tower with the Port Authority. 12 of his colleagues that day, not all of whom he actually knew, team up to carry him down all 64 floors to escape the tower. And he survives that day because they did, and because they made clear to him that he wasn't going to be left behind. And of course, they didn't fully understand at that point that they were risking their own lives, because not everyone really believed, or most people didn't understand, that the towers could actually collapse. You know, we had been through this in 1993 with the first bombing, and people sort of thought this was going to be the same thing. It would involve evacuation, and then, you know, the firefighters thought it might even take a couple of days to put the fires out, but they did not initially understand that the buildings were in danger of falling. And that this sort of confusion and lack of understanding about what we were living through that day just becomes the universal theme throughout that day. And of course, it was hindered in many ways by the communications technology available at the time. I mean, we think of 9/11 as part of our modern world. In I think many ways you can argue that 9/11 is the beginning of our modern world. It is probably as clear a dividing line as we have between the 20th century and the 21st. But the technology that we had in 2001 was the comparative Stone Age. President Bush's traveling party that day had some of the most cutting-edge technology available then. They had two-way pagers. And the really fancy two-way pagers, where when you got a page, you could send one of 14 different pre-programmed responses to the page. So that's the way the president that morning ends up learning of the crash for the first time. The traveling party first learns of the first crash by pager on the drive to Emmer Booker Elementary School. And then over the course of much of the rest of the day, he is hidden aboard Air Force One, rushed into the air in Sarasota, Florida, off to first Barksdale Air Force Base, and then ultimately Offutt Air Force Base, in part because Offutt Air Force Base in 2001 was the only place outside of Washington, D.C. where you could host a video teleconference if you were the president. Now, of course, the president travels with a briefcase that can plug into any Ethernet jack in the world and host that exact same press conference, or that exact same video conference. But that morning aboard Air Force One, there was no email, there was no cable, there was no satellite TV. And so the President of the United States was relying on rabbit ears antennas to pick up local TV coverage as Air Force One is flying around the southern United States. And as the TV coverage would fade in as they got closer to an urban area and then fade out as they flew past it. And so you're sort of left over the course of the day with this incredible realization that for most of the day, the President of the United States actually knew less about what was transpiring in the country below than the average American sitting at home watching CNN. And it's sort of these types of observations, these types of emotions and senses and themes that I think end up being so critical to understanding 9/11, not as the way that we tell it in history, but in the way that we actually live it. Because the confusion of that day is the thing that we sort of most remember as individuals standing around. And that, again, this is true if you are the president, if you are a school child, or you are one of these first responders. One of the other, to me, sort of breathtaking quotes in the book is Denise Miller, the police sergeant in Indian Lake, Pennsylvania, one of the small communities around Shanksville, who ends up being one of the first police officers on the scene of Flight 93. And she talks about, you know, how she's arriving at the crash scene, and she knows four facts about the day. She knows that two planes have hit the World Trade Center, a plane has hit the Pentagon, and this plane has crashed in this field. And so she's standing there in the abandoned coal mine that was the crash scene in Shanksville, Pennsylvania, assuming that the terrorists meant to crash the plane into this particular field, which is not a bad assumption if the only four facts you have that morning are that the other two planes hit the World Trade Center, the other one hit the Pentagon, and then there's this one. So she's standing there scared because she doesn't know what is buried under the field that the government has that the terrorists are trying to blow up. And she also knows that there were two planes that hit the World Trade Center. So she's standing there scared, looking into the sky, looking for the other planes that are coming to crash into that field. Because again, this was all she knew at the time, and sort of this, you know, for much of that day, you know, none of us understood why United Airlines Flight 93 had crashed. We didn't even really understand that day whether it had crashed or whether it had shot down, or it had been shot down. And that the story of the shootdown order sort of ends up being its own fascinating window into that day. Vice President Cheney is rushed into that bunker under the North Lawn of the White House, built by Harry Truman, never used for its intended purpose on any day before or since. But for that morning, it becomes the nation's command center. And Vice President Cheney is hidden around in there, again, with very limited technology. The technology in that day was in the bunker was so limited that he couldn't actually turn the volume up on both the video teleconference and the TV. So he's sitting there sort of all day trying to decide, am I listening to the video teleconference or am I listening to the TV, because I can't do both. And shortly after 10 a.m., Commander Anthony Barnes, the director of the bunker that day, Navy officer, aviator, comes to him and says, we need authority to shoot down any further hijacked airliners. Now, Commander Barnes had never spoken publicly before. He talked to me, and he told me in the book sort of the story of that conversation, where he understood the momentousness of what he was asking. And so he gets permission from Cheney. Then he goes back and asks Cheney repeatedly, again and again, for permission to shoot down the hijacked airliners. He wants to be incredibly clear that there is no ambiguity on either the vice president's end or the end of the Pentagon about what their orders are. And finally, Vice President Cheney sort of gets angry at him and says, yes, I've already told you, shoot down the hijacked airliners. And then that order ends up getting transmitted to the fighter pilots who are being rushed into the sky that day. Again, part of this improvised response that day, because we weren't prepared. We were not planning, we did not have any plans or procedures for an attack that came from within our borders. So at Andrews Air Force Base in outside DC, Heather Penny and Mark Sassville are the two fighter pilots scrambled into the air, both of their planes without any weapons at all. And they understand as they are racing out to their planes on the tarmac that they are being sent up on a kamikaze mission, that if they encounter a hijacked airliner, the one weapon that they have is their own fighter jet. And they understand that if they are successful that day, neither one of them will return to base. And so they are shouting back and forth across the tarmac as they load themselves into the planes. You aim for the cockpit, I'll aim for the tail. And they rush into the sky. And this is where, sort of, again, you have to realize the confusion that everyone is dealing with that day. And there's sort of become these huge gaps in the story of the day and the difference between the impact that people actually have and the experience that they are having. What none of the people involved in this understand is that it's all over. Vice President Cheney gives the shootdown order at 10:12 that morning. The best the 9/11 Commission can untangle is that he gave the order somewhere between 10:12 and 10:18 that morning. Heather Penny and Mark Sassville don't even get into the sky. Their fighters don't take off until about 10:30. And of course, United Airlines Flight 93 crashed at 10:03 in Shanksville. They don't know that. They don't know that there are no further hijacked planes in the sky and that the whole thing is over before the fighter jets even get there. And yet, that sort of for much of that morning, we didn't really know what we had done. We didn't really understand whether the attacks were still unfolding. And it wasn't until about 4 o'clock that afternoon Eastern time that the last plane was grounded, a US Airways flight from Madrid actually was the last plane, last commercial plane grounded that day. And then ultimately sort of the country realizes that it's actually all over. But then of course what we don't know is what's coming the next day, what's coming on 9/12, what's coming in October. And I think if you had asked President Bush on 9/12 and told him sort of the following two true facts, I don't know which he would have found more surprising. That in the next 18 years, Al-Qaeda would never successfully attack the US homeland again. Or that for the 18th anniversary of 9/11, his successor would invite the Taliban to Camp David. That sort of both of those facts would seem completely inconceivable to him on the morning of 9/12. And that sort of trying to go back and capture that confusion, that fear, I think is the story that we need to make sure that we remember as we talk about 9/11 going forward and try to hand off to a new generation the world that we created out of that emotion. I will leave it there, and you can take a couple of questions and dive a little bit deeper into any of this as you all would like. We've got a microphone over here if anyone has a question. Yeah. Give just a chance for the mic to run over. Okay, I'll repeat. Yeah. The question was sort of there's a section in the book that deals with or that follows the ticket clerks who check in the hijackers on the morning of 9/11. The hijackers, of course, check in Newark, at Dulles, in Boston, and for reasons that are sort of still unclear to us all these years later, two of them, including Mohammed Atta, check in Portland, and they take this early morning commuter jet into Boston before picking up the hijacked plane. In some ways, it is one of the things that is sort of so hard, and actually one of the characters, they're all real people, but one of the people in the book sort of talks about this, that it was a New York City firefighter talking about as he was evacuating the North Tower, he felt that he could hear the spooky music playing, that sort of the spooky music that plays just before the monster arrives in the movie, or sort of the thing jumps out from behind the door. And that sort of one of the things that becomes so clear in this book as you sort of go back and look at this is sort of all of these moments where you sort of want to reach through the pages and scream, like, don't get on the plane, or don't do that. And one of the sort of most poignant, I think, is actually the story of the ticket clerks that morning, because they talk about how they actually went to extra effort to get the hijackers on the plane, that they did their jobs. You know, the hijackers were running late. Mohammed Atta was running late. And that they see these passengers come in, they have first class tickets, and they're like, okay, no, we can still get you on board. And he says in the book, Mr. Atta, you must go now, you will miss your plane. And it sort of becomes this moment where you sort of think about how different the world would be and sort of the way that things would have unfolded in alternate futures and alternate universes. And he talks about how one of the things that I do try to capture in the book throughout is, you know, 9/11 is not over. You know, for the people who lived it, for us as a country, this is still something that we are wrestling with. And the clerk talks about how he really sort of suffered this mental anguish afterwards, and how he just sort of didn't feel like there was any room for him in the grief of 9/11. And he would sort of try to go to these support groups, and then he would be like, well, like, what? All right, you're saying you lost a family member. What do I say? I let the hijackers on the plane. And that he sort of has this thing where every time someone says, you know, I lost my husband, or I lost my mother, he hears, you killed my husband, you killed my mother. And that 9/11 is still something that we are sort of struggling with thinking about, and the mental anguish and the PTSD that has unfurled through it. And, you know, Will Jimeno, who's one of the Port Authority police officers, there were only two people rescued from underneath the towers, Will Jimeno and his sergeant, John McLaughlin. They were the stars of the that movie that some of you may have seen, World Trade Center, with Nicolas Cage. And Will Jimeno talks about that, how for him, the day that he beats PTSD will be the day that he is put in the ground. And that for him, he understands that sort of this is something that he's going to live with for his entire life. And he actually, and I don't actually mean, he is one of the most inspirational people that I met in the course of this. He was trapped under the towers until about 11 o'clock that night. the three other officers who were with his Port Authority team all killed in the collapse around him, and he and John McLaughlin lives. And he talks about how, you know, he goes around and he talks to school kids and actually inmates and addicts now. And he talks about this experience and he says, you know, I had 220 stories of the World Trade Center fall on top of me. But we all in our lives have our World Trade Centers that fall on us. And that, it, you know, for some of us, it's the loss of a family member. For some of us, it's the loss of a job. For some of us, it's thinking that we can't even make it through the midterm next week. And that for him, sort of his message is, you know, it's all about how you handle the World Trade Center when it falls on you. That is what ends up mattering. But of course, you know, when I say we're still living with 9/11, I mean, we're of course still also seeing the unfolding of the deaths thereafter. You know, this summer we actually marked Dan Nigro, who's one of the main characters in the book, and was the highest ranking New York City fire official to survive that day. The morning after 9/11, he becomes chief of department for FDNY, and today he's actually the fire commissioner. This summer, Dan Nigro announced the death of the 200th firefighter from World Trade Center related injuries and diseases. So, you know, for you know, a department that saw 343 people die that day, they've now lost two-thirds of that number in the years since. So. Down here.
During your research, did you come across the type of flight instruction that these hijackers received? I heard that they were concerned about flying, but very little interest in landing. Did that come out in your research, the type of instruction that they took?
Yeah, and you know, this particular book sort of doesn't deal with that because it's very tightly focused on 9/11 itself. My previous work, I've sort of covered some of that in my FBI research and writing before. And again, you sort of... when we look back with the hindsight available afterwards, there were multiple opportunities that we could have had as a country to disrupt those attacks. You know, one of the reasons that we actually know on 9/11 that it's an Al-Qaeda attack that quickly is that two of the hijackers on the manifest are people we know are Al-Qaeda, and that the CIA had actually known were inside the United States and had never told the FBI. And that the FBI had been fighting to get access that summer to those two names, and the CIA wouldn't turn them over. There's sort of a lot of those types of things that do unfold. And of course, you know, one of the things, and when you're talking to sort of people who have no memory of life before 9/11 that is sort of equally confounding to them, right, is the idea, like, in 2001 you could carry knives on board. You know, that sort of, people are like, well, how did the planes get hijacked? And you're like, oh, well, the hijackers just carried some knives on board. And everyone today is like, why on earth were you allowed to carry a knife on board a plane? You know, like, I can't even bring my water bottle on the plane anymore. And that again sort of falls into the category of the things that we forget about just how much 9/11 changed. But you sort of saw it in that little excerpt that, you know, we just never considered a plane as a missile before. And so for, you know, the air traffic controllers that morning, you know, they're concerned because it's a hijacking, but they, you know, they're going through their standard protocols and saying, you know, all right, well, let's clear the traffic away, and the plane's going to fly wherever the plane wants to fly, and then it'll land, and then we'll negotiate with them, and we'll send some pizzas out to the plane, and then, you know, the hostages get off, and they get their ransom money, and sort of everyone day goes on. And that, you know, it's just sort of that mindset that, again, is sort of so hard to capture today. Because, of course, you know, what makes Flight 93 different than the first three is it was 45 minutes late, right? You know, thank God for airport congestion in Newark, which is the one thing that is always constant in American life. And so the plane takes off from Newark 45 minutes later than it's supposed to, which means that when the passengers on board start calling down to the ground to say that they are that their plane's been hijacked, their family members are telling them about the Twin Towers and about the Pentagon, and they realize what has happened, and they realize that they need to take the plane back or they are going to become the next missile. So there's a question back up in here. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. When last time we were attacked, and I wonder if you could reflect on that and how that impacted the country as similar to what 9/11 did.
Yeah. I think it is true that when you look at American history, that there are sort of three moments that sort of each generation subsequently has burned into them. Pearl Harbor, the Kennedy assassination, and 9/11. And that when you look back, and those of you in the audience of a certain vintage may remember this, that in the years after Pearl Harbor, like Pearl Harbor Day was a real thing, that it was, you know, not quite a national holiday, but it was a day that was marked and observed. And it was, the type of thing, like, you didn't schedule super fun things to take place on December 7th in the same way that sort of today, like, we don't, you know, we try to avoid, you know, large celebratory events on 9/11. And that memory, you know, it sort of becomes replaced for a next generation with the Kennedy assassination. And to me, sort of one of the most, one of the sort of weirdest realizations that I had in this book is, you know, I have a one-year-old daughter, and that for her, 9/11 will be as removed historically as the Kennedy assassination was to me, someone born in 1981. And that sort of just, you know, to me, like, I'm a history buff, and like the Kennedy assassination, like, could not be more ancient history. And you know, I write about it as, you know, real history. Like, I covered the 50th anniversary of the Kennedy assassination. And the idea that sort of for my daughter, 9/11 will be sort of as weirdly removed to her is unimaginable to me, because I can tell you sort of every day, every minute of that day as it unfolded for me, and I have this incredibly boring story about eating breakfast in college. And that's sort of one of the things when you talk to, and maybe some of your parents in the room who were alive for Pearl Harbor remember this, one of the things that I sort of remember about people telling stories about, you know, parents or grandparents talking about Pearl Harbor Day is that they sort of talk about it still in the present tense, that they sort of talk about it as, you know, I was here, I was doing this, you know, we did that. And that's in many ways the way that we sort of tell our own 9/11 stories in this generation, I think. So,
one more question, please.
All right, last question. Down here.
In your research, there were several Army veterans that were involved. Did the name Rick Rescorla come up in your...
Yes.
Director of what, Port Authority of Security at the Towers?
Rick Rescorla. You might be conflating two different people, both of whom I devote a couple of pages to in the book. Rick Rescorla was this sort of incredible Well, actually, both of these people are incredible, larger-than-life characters. Rick Rascorla, former British paratrooper turned Vietnam vet who was the director of security for Morgan Stanley. And Morgan Stanley, one of the firms that gets religion about evacuation planning after the 93 bombing in the Twin Towers. And he leads this incredible evacuation of Morgan Stanley from the South Tower before, in the opening minutes of the first attack, and ultimately saves hundreds of lives of Morgan Stanley employees and ultimately loses his own life as he and two of his other security personnel sort of stay in the building to sort of go floor by floor to make sure everyone has evacuated. And then there was John O'Neill, who is probably a name familiar to those of you who have read or watched the Looming Tower series, who was the FBI's lead Al-Qaeda investigator and had led the hunt for Osama bin Laden through the Kenya and Tanzanian embassy bombings in 1998, the USS Cole bombing in 2000, and again, coming up with sort of the fate and the luck. In August 2001, retires from the FBI and starts in early September as the director of security for the World Trade Center, and dies in the tower, in the South Tower, during its collapse that morning. And there's sort of, I was actually, on Thursday, I was speaking at the 9/11 Museum in New York and was talking with the last person who saw John O'Neill alive, and who was another FBI agent. And, it's sort of this incredibly, incredibly sort of just tragic story of this guy who really more than anyone in the U.S. government sort of, is ringing the alarm bell of Al-Qaeda, is not listened to, retires in frustration from the FBI in August 2001, and, thinks he's, throwing in the fight, and then Osama bin Laden comes to him 2 weeks later. Thank you all for coming. I will be out in the lobby.
One second, sorry. Do we have a change for today? Sorry for the last minute, but because we have the 3D exhibit, we have some changes. One, unfortunately, there will be no cookies and coffee tonight. Sorry. And also, we are going to have the book signing table here on the stage. And so please, go buy your books and queue up in line along the side. And again, it was brilliant. It really was.